guys, what's going on? It's your boy George Mackay and
Uncle Bobby B. What's happening?
And we are here with another MLW Rewind, and we are rewinding tonight's Battle Riot 5. It was filled with ups. It was filled with surprises. It was filled with legends. And it was filled with Gene Snitsky. Yes, you heard me right. Gene Snitsky was a part of this year's Battle Riot. And we'll get into all our reactions and thoughts on everything. But let's start off with who was one and who was two. Number one was none other than the leader of the Boumaier Fight Club, Alex Kane, the Suplex Assassin. Drawing number one. I was a little bit shocked on that. I knew he had a low number. I thought he was top 10. I figured he was in the early stages. I did not think he was going to be number one overall. What was your thoughts on Alex Kane and his record-breaking run in Battle Riot this year?
Honestly, when I saw him come in at number one, I had a feeling how the match was going to go.
Did you feel that it was going to go? Well, we're obviously, I mean, if you've watched Battle Riot, great, then you already know the outcome. If you haven't, spoilers ahead. But did you think that the outcome was going to be the outcome?
I had a feeling as soon as I saw him come in number one. Here's the thing. If Alex came in at like 12, or if he came in at like 28, I would have maybe had a different, but because he came in at one, I'm like, they're going to tell a story here. And that's going to be the story of Alex Kane outlasting everybody. I didn't anticipate he was going to set a record, but he did. Broke the record set by Tom Lawler.
Tom Lawler was 42 minutes, I believe. And yeah. Alex Kane not only broke it, but surpassed it by an additional 8 minutes, going just over 50 minutes long in Battle Riot. The longest lasting member in MLW history of the roster. So kudos to Alex Kane on that one.
And it was not your typical Battle Riot, because we had the calling just come in and fucking destroy.
Destroy everybody. Everyone. Now, correct me, refresh my memory. Who was number two?
Number two was...
And number two was Willie Mack.
Willie Mack. I thought that was a great way to start it off. Two guys who can... Who can go right off the bat.
Both have a very... I'm not going to say sleeper-like agility, but both... You don't expect to be... you expect the ground and pound. You expect the hardcore fighting styles of both these guys. You expect the striking ability and obviously the technical ability, but you don't expect the high flying ability, at least of Willie Mack. Even though I've seen Willie Mack fly so many times, still it amazes me how that guy can move around a ring.
Yeah, because it's one thing to say like, oh, you know, he can go off the top and he can do it, but like you got to look at really how agile he is, like quickly his body moves and shifts position and shifts weight in midair, like. That's not easy for a guy that size. So how he manages to do it just blows my mind, but he does. And they both have a lot of energy. So it was a great pick to start off Battle Riot this year.
Absolutely. We had a lot of big names out in the early gates. And like Rob said, about around entry number 11 or 12, the entire calling just came out and decimated and destroyed everybody, pretty much clearing the ring, leaving only Juicy Finau in the ring until... Jacob Fatu, the Samoan Werewolf, he comes in and he cleans house. He takes out all the important members of the calling, eventually eliminating himself and Ricky Shane Page the first time around. Yes, you heard me right. The first time around. Fighting all the way to the back before Ricky would enter later on around the mid-30s. And he wouldn't even make it to the ring because Jacob would again come out and beat him. So that is the great thing about Battle Riot is that it sets up stories. Finish up stories and it starts new stories. So obviously Jacob Fatu will be the man taking the fight to the calling, and the Samoan SWAT team will be very much involved in all of that. I honestly and truly see Ricky and Akira maybe going after the tag titles against the Samoan SWAT team, and Jacob Fatu definitely has his sights set on getting back into that heavyweight title picture. Unfortunately, though, tonight would not be his night. Now, as we wind down through Battle Riot, like I said, we had some legends and surprises show up. We had Kim Chi show up again, who was quickly handled by Alex Kane. And then we had another legend of old times, the man who was the first man to ever hit Jerry the King Lawler over the head with a trash can. And that is none other than Duke the Dumpster Drosy. Came out looking great, fantastic. There was one great moment after he hit O'Shea Edwards a few times with the trash can. Alex Kane went for the ankle lock. But he went for the ankle lock on Duke's prosthetic leg. Not sure he realized that Duke does have a prosthetic leg. And he does. He has a prosthetic. He did lose a limb in his fight with diabetes. But Alex Kane tried to go for the ankle lock. And then when he realized that it was the prosthetic leg, Alex Kane does what Alex Kane does best. He tried to detach the prosthetic leg Tuke the Dumpster Drosy. And you could only laugh at this because at this point, Alex Kane had been in the match for just over 35 minutes. He was gassed. He was exhausted. He was literally grasping at anything he could get his hands on that leg to try to twist the ankle. And the funny thing was, Duke, it was funny because when he put Duke in the ankle lock, did you see Duke's face? He looked at the ref like, nothing hurts. I'm okay.
You see Alex's face when the leg was twisting like way more than it should be, like, twisting?
What is happening
like,
here?
What is going on here? Like, it's not broken. And I mean, I'll be honest, I popped. Like, Duke Drosy is one of those guys that if you're around the same age I am, you grew up watching the old WWF. You saw Duke Drosy back in that era of the Fed. And like, I don't know, everyone just kind of has like fond memories of this guy playing a garbage man character, a sanitation engineer.
That's right, sanitation specialist, if you will.
So, you know, he didn't do a whole lot in there. The poor guy has got a prosthetic leg, but it was fun to see him come out there.
He came out with the trash can, and shout out to O'Shea Edwards making his official in-ring MLW debut. We've seen him with the Boomae Fight Club, former member of Shane Taylor Promotions. If you watched old school ROH from literally like 2 years ago before they were closed down and went on their hiatus and eventually bought by Tony Khan. Sorry. But yeah, it was great to see him get in the ring and get some minutes. Definitely good to see him back. Also, let's talk Ray Jazz. Yeah. Let's talk Ray Jazz. So Ray Jazz, one half of the FBI, came out shortly after Little Guido was eliminated quite easily, by the way. Little Guido eliminated without really much effort.
He tried to superplex Micro Man. He put a target on his back.
Yeah, as soon as you got, and Lince Dorado was in there, Calvin Tank was in there. They were not having any of that. We should also talk about Mance Warner eliminating himself. And who else did he eliminate? He eliminated somebody else. Can't remember who it was.
I think it was somebody from The Calling. He took one for the team.
Yeah,
it might have been Akira or Ricky. I can't remember.
Somebody. Yeah, he took one for the team and he eliminated himself. And Matt Justice never actually made it to the ring because The Calling attacked him to the back. Now, Manders, since we're talking SGC quickly before we get back to Ray Jazz, Manders had a great spot with John Hennigan. He was in the final five, and he hung on to the bottom rope after getting thrown over the top with his cowboy boots before John went through the middle rope, doing kind of a coup de grace, if you will, Finn Balor style, stomped on his chest, so Manders was eventually eliminated, but still a pretty cool spot. Pretty cool spot for Manders, for sure. And now back to what we were talking about, which was
Ray Jazz.
This kid has the brightest future out of anyone. We saw Alex Kane 3 years ago. We knew we saw something special. Now we're putting our chips in on Ray Jazz. He's impressive. He's young. He's hungry. When Rob and I were watching, the first thing I said to Rob was, he reminds me of a young Randy Orton. Like, fresh and green, we're talking evolution Randy Orton.
And like, remember the first time we saw Ray Jazz with FBI? I said, man, like, he didn't get a whole lot of ring time, but he looked like this kid, who I'm not familiar with at the time, looked really good. Like, and since we've seen him perform more and more, tons of, like, this guy's incredibly athletic. He's an amateur wrestler, so he gets mat wrestling. Looks to me like he's taken to pro wrestling pretty quick.
Mm-hmm.
He's a tremendously athletic.
He's got the look.
Tons of upside.
Absolutely. And unfortunately, the upside was cut short by Alex Kane, who put him in the chokehold into the crocodile roll with the scissor lock, and it was pretty much over for Ray Jazz. His night was done within 30 seconds of him entering. But still, not the quickest elimination.
No.
The quickest elimination of the night goes to an Azteca henchman. I believe it was number 32. He came in to Ricky Shane Page chokehold, who threw him right over the top. Literally 0.1 of a second, and he was done. Now, let's talk Alex Kane. As we got deeper into this, the final four were John Hennigan, Alex Kane, Davey Boy Smith,
Shigeru Iri,
who is the WXW champion. If anybody knows that promotion out in Germany, he is the WXW champion. And he put on quite a show. Now, it was pretty much Hennigan and Kane that were going back and forth. Davey, and how do you say his name? I don't want to say it wrong.
Shigeru.
They were going at it in one corner. And surprisingly enough, Alex Kane did get one up on John Hennigan. He was able to get him out, get him over. And that was the final three. The final three was pretty much that. And then as quick as that happened, WXW champion went after Davey, tried to go over the top. Davey kind of threw him over, lunged him out, and it was down to the final two. And you can't write these moments. I mean, you can, but you can't. Davey Boy Smith and Alex Kane staring each other down one-on-one. And how about the finish that was karma? It was very karma because Alex Kane put Davey Boy Smith, like he did a few episodes back, in that no ropes catch wrestling
rear naked choke,
dropped him in the center of the ring, Davey had nowhere to go. He did try to roll, but Alex locked in the scissor lock, and Davey was grasping at the ref. He was trying everything he could do to just hang on, and he couldn't. Karmatic finish. Alex Kane is your new number one contender, winner of this year's Battle Riot, and he punched a golden ticket because he actually had one. The entire Boomhaya Fight Club brought out a golden ticket, very Willy Wonka style, to Alex Kane as he was carried over the shoulders of Mr. Thomas and O'Shea Edwards. And he is now your number one contender. He can cash in for that title shot any damn time he chooses.
We could have renamed this this event Alex Kane and the Boomhaya Chocolate Factory, because basically he came in number one, and like, just like Willy Wonka's Chocolate Factory, every other single person that came in with him eventually dropped off until he was the sole survivor, the only one remaining standing in the middle of the ring. And let's talk about the fact that Alex is, he's a heel, okay? He was in there with Davey Boy Smith, who's the babyface. And no disrespect to Davey, but the crowd was 100% behind Alex Kane. Boomhaya chants all night. This guy is so over. It's been such a pleasure over the last 2 years to watch his growth, to watch the faith that MLW and
Corp. 3 years. This is year number three. That's right.
Yeah, to the faith that has been placed in him by MLW and Corp Bauer, seeing that pay off. It's great. And clearly, you know, they feel Alex is the next guy to at least challenge Hammerstone, if not defeat Hammerstone. Who knows what's going to happen?
I feel like as much as I love Hammer's run, it's been a historic run for MLW, for Hammer for sure. I feel like Hammer's time has come and gone in terms of a championship run.
Really?
I do. I feel like we haven't had a heel champion since Tom Lawler. We have not had a heel champion since Tom Lawler.
Jacob Fatu
was a heel, but he was much like Kane. He was over. Even with Contra, he was over.
Sure, he was over, but...
You're contradicting yourself right there by saying Kane is a heel, but he's over. So it's the same formula as Jacob Fatu. Heel, but over.
Yes, heel, but over. I understand. Back and to the left.
Yes. Yes, back and to the left. Make him make the first move, Conway. That's how things roll, man. Quoting Mighty Ducks 3. Listen, at the end of the day, Alex Kane put on one hell of a show, outlasting 39 other men. Well, actually 38 other men, because Matt Justice never made it to the
end. And one woman.
Yeah, and one woman, Ty Valkyrie, a two-time entrant into the Battle Riot. It was fantastic to see her. And Alex Kane took her out quite convincingly. Alex Kane at one point was pulling a Stone Cold Steve Austin. If you remember that historic Royal Rumble run where somebody would come in the ring and Stone Cold would get rid of him, and Alex would end up just waiting. He would just be in the ring waiting for the additional 10 or 15 seconds of that minute to get the next man up. So Alex Kane, put on one hell of a show. He now holds the record for the longest man in a Battle Riot. And he's punched his ticket to the main show. And, I mean, if we look at the openweight title, like it should, it's very reminiscent of the old school Intercontinental title, mm-hmm. where if you are donning that, you are definitely one of the next man up.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Everyone that's held that title is one of the guys that, you know, will eventually become a world champion in MLW. And Alex Kane is going to be on that list. And he's on that short list. Now, as to how long the Boomhaya Fight Club will last before Alex Kane does outgrow them, and he will, I'm not sure. But right now, that's the hottest faction in MLW, next to the Calling and Small and SWAT team. And Alex Kane is the hottest star in there right now. He was so over. The crowd was so elated when he won. It couldn't have been a better night for Corp Bauer and team. So kudos to everyone in MLW. All the surprises were great. Let's talk Gene Snitsky for a second. We got to talk Gene Snitsky. He came out looking very much like Gene Snitsky does, a little bit more leaner, if you will, but still had the presence. And unfortunately, mob mentality kicked in and he was eliminated during the commercial break by four guys. Actually, five. Leo Rush came in at the very end when he was already over. So I guess Leo Rush counts as part of the team that helped eliminate him. But it took five men to get rid of Gene Snitsky. So kudos to that. And also got to give a kudos to Ricky Shane Page after eliminating Calvin Tankman. The nice little solid wave and bye-bye was nice. That was nice. Was a nice touch.
You can put like that's so Ricky just to do something like that. Like he's like a badass, but he's also like sarcastic as shit.
Now, are you surprised at all? I got to ask you this question. Are you surprised at all that the SCG, SGC, my apologies, didn't have more of a showing? Matt Justice pretty much never made it to the ring. Mance Warner took one for the team by eliminating one of the Calling. And Manders had that spot with Henningen, but really nothing on the None of them lasted longer than under 5 minutes. The two that did make it to the ring.
And I think, like just to pull the curtain back a little bit, I believe some of these guys wrestled more than one match that night. So it might have also been a matter of let's kind of not blow these guys up. But, yeah, they didn't have a big showing. I think that
I figured after War Chamber, there might be a little bit more of a karmatic side of things for there. I'm using that word a lot lately. I'm liking it. I thought there might be more of a little payback for the calling. Like when the calling came out, I figured SGC was going to follow. I really did, but they stayed to the course. They stayed to their numbers. Obviously, that feud is not over, but now the calling is definitely going to be putting all their eyes on Jacob Fatu.
Yeah, and I think and along with that comes the Samoan SWAT team. So I think that's kind of the angle they're running with now. But I did want to just shout out a couple. It was great to see Hot Sauce, Trace Williams. ROH alumni, obviously.
Cashflow Ken Broadway was in the house.
Some really good showing. Juicy Finau, I thought, had a great showing.
Bled quite a bit, actually. They took a fork to his skull, and it was not pretty to see Juicy bleeding that much. Lance, surprisingly enough, sorry to cut you off.
No.
Lance did not have a great showing. Lance is actually the first elimination of the night was Lance Wine.
He came in hot, like, real hot, just Savat kicking everybody, but he fizzled out pretty quick. But that's okay. I mean, he's the record holder for most battle riots. He's eliminated his father from a battle riot. How many people can say they've did that? Sure. So you know what? Tag team champion. I don't think he's going to be that upset about not getting that golden ticket. But yeah, you know, it was a fun battle riot. It was different than the previous ones. The way they broke it up with the calling coming in and kind of destroying everyone. And then Jacob Fatu coming in and taking out most of the calling and then
taking out everybody except for Ricky. Well, actually taking out Ricochet Page along with himself.
Right. And then how it ended with Alex Kane. I thought it was pretty like these matches are, if I'm the guy with the pencil, it's a hard thing to book, but I think they did a really good job of telling multiple stories within this 45 minute match.
How about Joe Dombrowski and Matt Stryker on some commentary gold? Joe was the best. Jacob Fatu has never been eliminated for a battle riot. He won one and he was arrested before he could enter the other.
And Matt Stryker quoting Jebediah Springfield was also a high point for me. But yes.
And also, Joe, I don't know if he was marking for Matt Stryker, but saying you've had some endurance matches, talking about Matt Stryker's few appearances in Royal Rumbles where he was eliminated in under 2 minutes flat.
Yeah.
But talking about Matt Stryker's, you know, Matt, you've been in these high endurance matchups. How do you last? And it was, I've said it before, I'll say it again, man. Joe and Matt, when they're on commentary, they just hit different in all the fucking right ways. But credit to those guys for being the great narrators to a great night of storytelling by Core Power and team. I enjoyed it thoroughly. And anybody else we want to shout out for Battle Ride that you were excited to see or that you were cool, kind of got a moment or two in the ring?
No, I think we pretty much hit everybody. Like, it was great performances all around. Nobody looked like they phoned it in. Nobody looked like they were
Well, off. Now, hold on. We do have to mention that one chicken fight spot that did look like
That was not good. It was nobody's fault. Like, Lindsay just couldn't get Microman kind of up enough to...
Oh, we also have to talk about how Microman got eliminated. He was elimination number 3 or 4 for Alex Kane, and he got choked out.
Yeah, Alex Kane choked him. Dropped his ass.
Dropped him. Dropped him from waist height, and for a man Microman size, that's pretty high up. Yeah. And he dropped him. He face-planted him pretty damn hard. And then as he dropped him, he yelled at the ref, "Get that shit out of my ring." So...
Microman, like, between Real One and Alex Kane, just the target of verbal abuse.
Very much so. And there was actually a funny part was, again, to shout out Little Guido, trying to get Microman on, I don't know, he wrapped himself around the top turnbuckle in the top right corner. And trying to get him, Microman held on for dear life, though. So kudos. Microman's got some grit, man. Be careful of that little dude. How about also biting the leg of Beast Man and then 2 kendo sticks to the nuts?
Yeah.
Microman using the kendo stick to his full advantage on Beast Man. Shout out to Beast Man, OTT alumni.
We haven't seen Beast Man in ages, but he had a pretty significant spot in this match.
He had a pretty significant spot. I mean, he's not, you know, he's not Dr. Gord Wallace or AKA Dr. Dax.
Dr. Corn Wallace?
It's Gord. It's Gord, but Corn was said. Yes, you are right. Corn was said. And we won't talk about that because, you know, we don't talk about commentary mistakes. They happen. They happen, my friend. They happen. But regardless of the fact, this one was the entertaining battle riot. Now, there have been 5 battle riots. Rob and I have been honored and privileged enough to talk about 3 of them. And I believe we've watched 4 of them. So out of all the 4 that we've watched, because I've never watched the first one. I should go back through the archives and check it out. But I've watched 2, 3, 4, and 5. Where would you rank this Battle Riot out of the four you've watched so far?
I think this is probably my favorite one. I mean,
Really?
yeah, the other two were Jacob Fatu wins and they were awesome, but I just think,
well, Jacob only won one when he was arrested for the other.
I think this one just there was multiple stories told, and I liked the way they did that. I really liked how it was booked.
I like the outcome of this one for sure. Yeah. This one ranks up there as my favorite as well because the fact that a homegrown talent, man, Alex Kane was given the ball, now going into his third year at MLW. And he was, here's the ball, kid. And I remember Alex Kane telling me when he debuted at the first Battle Riot that he was in, Corey Power saying, don't worry, kid, they're going to love you. And yep, here we are. They loved him then. They love him now. Boom IA is for the kids. And Boom IA now has a shot at Alex Hammerstone in that World Heavyweight Championship. So it's going to be exciting to see when and if Alex Kane does punch in that ticket to challenge Hammer. And I don't know what or where. I know Alex Kane is ever the opportunist. So it'll be one of the most unexpected cash-ins. It won't be like Jacob Fatu. It won't be like, I'm challenging you at this day, at this time.
Yeah,
no. Alex Kane will surprise everyone when he does cash in that ticket. That's for sure.
I concur.
But oh, thank you. Thank you for concurring. Look at that. We concurred once in a while. It's only been 2 years we've concurred, finally.
We concur on things.
Not all the time.
It's concurrence.
Not a lot of concurrence. It's very karmatic concurrence. And on that note, with those high-level, fancy college words, I bid you adieu from your host, your boy, George Mackay, and the one and only...
Uncle Bobby B.
That's it for this one. It was short, it was sweet, it was simple, it was to the point. All the links to the socials are below. Please check, follow, like, subscribe, all that good stuff. Keep MLW Rewind coming back, and don't forget to check us out. If you don't want to look at us, I understand all the reasons why. Hear us, listen to us on SNME, Sunday Night Main Event. Peace, love, and wrestling. Take care.
Adios.